It's a pleasure to talk to you on this subject. Lots and lots of media attention is on this. So what is, okay, let me see how it works. Yeah, are extreme weather events on the rise? A short answer, no. A long answer, no, no, no. There are extreme weather always in the Earth's climate. Go back to 200, 500 years of good data, there were extreme weather always. So what is this present concern? It is because of media hype. I'll give you example. Just 2 months ago, there were New Orleans flood. Before that, there were Texas flood. And around in the US French Open tennis tournament, there were floods in northern Germany and France. So all our Canadian media tied up to, oh, it has to do something with global warming. Okay, let's go to the next. There are two groups of scientists who have proposed different mechanisms. IPCC started in 1988. They have provided five-yearly report, now about fourth five. NIPPCC, Non-Governmental International Panel on Climate Change, several hundred scientists now, Niklas Mörner, myself, and many others. First comprehensive report in 2009. Okay, what is the mechanism? IPCC says a warm weather, a warm climate holds more moisture. So because of more moisture, you have lots of rain in one area, no rain in another, droughts. So we have floods, droughts, along with that heat waves, and so on. Then IPCC says a more intense tropical cyclone, increase in extreme rainfall, decrease in cool days. IPCC says, we'll go with that later. NIPPC says extreme weather is a natural variability. It is part of natural climate system. An ENSO event, we talked about it quite a bit, causes extreme weather event in some part, floods in some parts, droughts in other parts. Intense interaction between cold and warm air, like the classical Birkenes model of 1916, can produce very cold on one side, very warm and wet and humid on the other side. That's what extreme weather is all about. Okay, this is the IPCC table of 2007. This is what the extreme weather events are provided by IPCC and how they will be rising in future. Mark that warm spell or warm days, cool nights, fewer and fewer cool nights. Next one, I define two kinds of extreme weather. Warm weather extreme as defined by the IPCC. So IPCC says heat waves, droughts will increase, while milder winter, very little snow. Climate reality, warm weather extremes have not really increased. Cold weather extremes on the other part have increased, and we will see how and why. Okay, let's go through some media hype quickly. Climate change in Canada, a bleak forecast. 1997, what could be bleak forecast? Climate can be awfully cold in winter, minus 40 degrees. Worse weather was than Canadians warmed by extreme weather. Time magazine was the leader in that global warming. Be worried. Our Maclean's magazine, 2012 was a mild winter, so decided winter died in Canada. No, no, no. Next year, winter came with a vengeance. The longest, coldest winter, 2013-14. Okay, heat waves, let's look at heat waves. North American Dust Bowl years, 1920s and 30s. They were the hottest decades in US in 100 years. 2012 and 2016 US summer heat was mild compared to that. 2003 Western European heat was extreme, agreed, and a lot of people died, but it was because of soil moisture condition. Moscow heat wave was due to atmospheric blocking. Pre-monsoon heat waves, May and June, of 1 week duration with temperature 40 degrees, 45 degrees, happen commonly every few years in India. Heat waves over Australia linked to ENSO phases. Record high temperature US, look at, see, 1930s was the hottest decade. Compared to 1930s, 2000, the new millennium is relatively mild, I would like to say. Thunderstorms and tornadoes. Highest thunderstorm activity in US during 20s and 30s. Deadliest tornado outbreak, 18th March 25, 747 dead in three Midwestern states. April 5, 36, 216 dead. Largest 2 days outbreak, 1974 April, over 140 tornadoes. That was a time when the mean temperature was declining, mind you. US annual strong tornadoes, F3, and there is no increasing trend. Yeah, 841, this is for this year, and just up to August. Now the highest one, I think, in last 7-8 years was 2011, very high number of tornadoes. But tornado count is actually declining. Hurricanes, typhoons, they are not increasing. As a matter of fact, in Atlantic, since Hurricane Katrina, there has been no hurricane of that strength hit landfalling anywhere. Hurricane Sandy, 2012, was only category 1 hurricane. Bay of Bengal tropical cyclone declining. Also, this is in Pacific typhoons. This is the data from Johnny Chan of Hong Kong. Bay of Bengal declining, but there is a variation. Extreme precipitation. Now, most of the extreme precipitation is associated with hurricanes or tropical cyclone in monsoonal climate as well. Highest 24-hour precipitation, 182 centimeters in South Atlantic, South Indian Ocean. Highest 1 month, July 1861, 930 centimeters. Where else but the wettest spot, Cherrapunji in Assam. Highest 1 year, 1860-61, 2,647 centimeters rain in 1 year. You can't take that kind of rain. So recent studies on human link to extreme weather, to extreme rainfall are without any merit. Most of these studies, they point rainfall, 50 millimeter, 100 millimeter, that's nothing compared to tropical cyclones or monsoonal rain, you see. Any given day, sometimes a torrential rain in monsoonal climate, monsoon season, can produce 150 to 200 millimeters of day rain in a day. Droughts, floods, and ENSO, one I've said earlier, ENSO events in the equatorial Pacific bring summer rains over US Canadian prairies. Cold events, on the other hand, are linked with drier summer. And El Nino and La Nina linked to droughts and floods in the Indian summer monsoon. ENSO and PDO, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, produce dry wet conditions over eastern Australia, Indonesia, Southeast China, and eastern Africa. ENSO is the single most largest cause of global extreme precipitation. Now this is the El Nino, September 97. Look at the amount of warm water around west coast of South America. The area of warm water, plus 2 degrees or about, is almost three quarters as large as the size of Canada. This was the strongest El Nino in 50 years. And this strong El Nino produced 1998 as the warmest year according to IPCC. Now they are declaring 2016, which is again linked to 2015 El Nino. Summer monsoon, India and South Asia. India, South Asian monsoon impacts 2 billion people every year. Major droughts occur irregularly, droughts as well as flood, in a 200-year excellent data set. ENSO is the major driver of South Asian monsoon. Besides ENSO, there are other factors, Indian Ocean Dipole, Quasi-biennial oscillation, to which Indrani Roy mentioned, and my own favorite thing, heavy snow accumulation during previous winter can produce a drier monsoon. Lots of studies have been done. Next, droughts and floods, they often come in back to back. Example, 18 flood, 17 drought. 1941 extreme drought, 42 flood. 87 extreme drought, 88 flood. 87 was an El Nino year, 88 was a La Nina year. 2009, recent one, 2010. I'll give you two examples here. Oh, major drought and flood. As you can see, very irregularly. Space, 200 years of very good data. Most drought years are linked with El Nino. Most flood years, or good monsoon year, as I call it, are linked with La Nina, and plus other factors, of course. The worst drought, 1877. I think less than 50% of the rain fell over whole of India. Several million cattle died, possibly several thousands of people died, but no good records were available. This happened more than 130 years ago. Two examples, 2009, a drought monsoon. Next year, 2010, a relatively good monsoon. Pakistan flood in late August, early September. And once again, there was media news, oh, this floods in Pakistan with 20% of the area underwater is certainly due to global warming. What else? Okay, now, our winter weather extremes on the rise. Let's look at it. Winter 2012, extreme cold in Czech Republic. Minus 40 degrees locally for almost a week. Several people died of cold, extreme cold, lack of heating or poor housing, etc. Winter 2003, heavy snows in Central Europe. March 2003, coldest month in Berlin, according to reports. 2013-14 winter, longest, coldest, and snowiest over North America. With several blizzards and heavy snows, February of 2014 saw heavy snow in Japan as well, also parts of China. Winter 2015, Boston broke all-time record, Boston, US, 300 centimeters of snow. Elsewhere, eastern Canada hit by several snowstorms with 50 centimeters minimum, especially in eastern Canada. Also, you might remember in Panjshir Valley in Afghanistan, heavy snow avalanches killed over 250 people in early February of 2015. So what is happening to the Earth's climate as we observe it? I am an observational guy. So let's look at it. This is the recent 23rd January 2016 in Washington area, a monster, 2 feet of snow, about $1 billion in damage. Schools and offices were closed for a few days to a week. Lots of work had to be done to remove the snow. Sometimes Washington doesn't have enough snow plows, especially further you go down into North Carolina. I remember my wife was there a few years ago. When there is snow, everything is stopped because there are no snow removal equipment. Anyway, this is in Washington. About a week later, unusual cold wave sweeps across East Asia, 65 kilometers. This is Taiwan. Just a week later. Why? Let's go a couple more. In Alaska, 2012 January, it is too much snow even for Alaska. 387 centimeters of snow fell in early January of 2012. Some more snowfall record, yes. 2012, Sunshine Ski Resort in Western Canadian Rockies, 910 centimeters of snow. Okay, now global weather-related disaster losses as a proportion of global GDP. This is the latest Munich Re graph. What it shows, a steady decline in the percentage impact of GDP on global weather disaster. The two peaks, Hurricane Katrina, one single Hurricane Katrina caused economic damage of over $150 billion. 2011, severe tornadoes in the United States, another spike in global weather disaster. Elsewhere, there are, of course, floods are there, I don't deny that. But as you can see, the amount of damage as relative to the GDP is declining. Okay, so what is the summary? The link between global warming and extreme weather is more perception than reality. The perception, because everybody talks, declined in recent years. Finally, a lighter side of the global warming science. Warming forecast glows bleaker. Thank you very much.